So I'll be talking to you about the medical management of keloid disorder. And as I told you yesterday morning, patients are at the heart of this disorder. So before I start talking, I want to invite mother of one of my patients to come here. She has a message for all of us, and I'd like us to hear that. Just historically, Alex is a patient of mine whom I met in 2011, and when I was working on Keloid Research Foundation, and we filed a paperwork with the State of New York. State of New York requires 3 signatures on the application for a non-for-profit entity. Alex's signature was one of those signatures. So I'm proud of him, and I'm glad to have him here. Rosalind, please come over here. I'll give you a few minutes to talk, and then I'll start my talk.
Thank you, Dr. Tirgan.
You're welcome.
God bless you, yes. Greetings to the moderator, to all the doctors who are here, scientists, advocates. I just want to say thank you, Dr. Tirgan, for how our paths have crossed again. I went into a health store the other day. It's a program that I often listen to, Invite Health. And I sat down with this doctor. His name is Dr. Hickey, and I'm sure if you drive around Manhattan or you're from out of state, you've seen Invite Health. So I went there and I sat down with him, and then I was talking to him about my son's problems, because his problem, surgery cannot help him. His problem has to be helped from the inside out, because we have tried surgeries and that's not a good option for my son. So immediately he took up his phone and he looked, and then he gave me the number. But, you know, I did not look at it until when I came home. And then when I showed it to my son, he said, "But Ma, don't you remember? I went to see Dr. Tirgan." And then so our paths have crossed again, and we called you. And then it's, as it turned out, you told us about the symposium. So I said, "Oh my goodness, I have to be here," because then of course you're gonna have the great minds and the brains from all over the world and all over the country. So I said, I will not miss it for the world. So all I want to ask of you scientists and doctors, please, if you could help my son. Ever since he was about 10 years old, he suffered with this keloid. It started right here. He got a little scar after chicken pox, and then it got bigger. We cut it off. I think he had 4 surgeries, and the last one, 5 surgeries. The last one took place in Houston, Texas, at by Dr. Kane and L. Harris, a very wonderful doctor, very caring. He's an, I can't pronounce the otolaryngologist, I just can't pronounce that. You know what I'm talking, facial reconstruction of the face and neck area. You know the term for that. He did the surgery in 2013. And we noticed that it started to, we used to go back and forth for treatment, because he developed this formula to, I don't know if it's a kind of hydrocortisone, something to that effect, to inject it. We kept going back.
I can explain what it does.
Okay, I will have you explain, because we don't want, okay.
Well,
you have to stand.
Stand up.
Okay. Yes.
But that had to happen so often that it was so expensive to try.
Going back and forth to Houston is no ball game. Yes, very expensive. You would have to go back every 3 to 6 months.
6-month or 18-month process, he said.
Right.
I mean, even though the surgery was taken care of and the treatments were free, it still wasn't free because we had to travel.
We have to travel. I mean, he cost $10,000. That's what it cost us, cash. Yes, he has to be licensed in New York, and he's not. So therefore, he couldn't, you know, he has to be careful with his license. You doctors, you know about that. Okay, so let me go on briefly. His problem, as I said, has to be healed from the cellular level. And I think if there is a bunch of you who are specialists in the field of genetics, I remember Dr. Russell that was over here, the older lady that gave such a beautiful talk. I think Dr. Polk, Susan, yes, and others. Even though she's veterinary, if you could just look into the areas of gene therapy for my son, I don't know how that works about the DNA and the messenger RNAs and stuff like that. If someone could just look into that for me, I would be so grateful. I mean, I don't want to use my son as a guinea pig, but, you know, whatever it takes for him, because, you know, he's 30 years old. He doesn't begin to live life yet. 3/4 of his life has been taken up with this horrible, horrific disease that has really, I mean, he tries to have a social life, but as a young man, with a degree from NYIT, and he's brilliant. He, you know, he has his own T-shirt business online. He works at night, but he could be working at what I sent him to school for. But once people take a look at him, they judge him because it's all about how you look. It's not what is in your brain. They don't care about that. So if you doctors, scientists, advocates could really help me and help Alex, especially him, not merely me, Alex, to, you know, do something at the cellular level. Because as I said before, his problem has to be taken care from the inside out, not from the other way around. Because we tried that mode already, and it really doesn't work for my son. So, I mean, I don't know. I heard all kinds of speculations about how this keloid began. Some say it's a bad vaccine that he may have been given as a child and all sorts of other things. But I know my ex-husband, who is his father, had a cut when he was a merchant marine, and he had a cut and it turned into a keloid, but he was in Germany and he had it excised, and it didn't grow back. It laid flat once they injected with the cortisone medication. But I just don't understand. That's all I have to say. I just want you to just help me to help my son or help my son. Thank you, Dr.
Tirgan. Thank you so much. Thank you.
God bless you. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So these are my disclosures. I have no financial disclosure. It's financial conflicts to disclose. I'm one of the organizers of the meeting. The work that I'm presenting today, although I'm on the staff at Rockefeller Hospital with Dr. Kruger, has nothing to do with Rockefeller. This was all done in my private office, and it's within my private practice. I'm going to present a few patients here, put it in the back of your mind. This is a 25-year-old Asian female who has this keloid up here. She has never had any prior treatments before, and the question is, what treatment would you recommend? I kind of perhaps know the answer. This is another patient who, 42-year-old female, keloid up here. She has been struggling with this since she was 26. She has had 2 surgeries on this already, multiple steroid injections, 5 if you many times. She had this keloid removed surgically twice, and then radiation therapy ended up with this outcome. And that would be another case. Third case, 25-year-old African-American female with this huge keloid. She's been struggling with this since she was 19. She has had 3 surgeries. She also has had radiation therapy. Despite that, this has reoccurred. Multiple intralesional steroid injections, and that's another question for us. And this is the back of her ear. This is, you see how big this keloid is. The fourth patient, 36-year-old female, struggling with chest keloid. She had, since she was a child, it's a long time. One surgery, this keloid immediately reoccurred after surgery. multiple intralesional steroids. What she was suffering from was very severe pain, to a point that she was ready to take her life. Nothing was relieving this pain. And this doesn't look that bad to you, but it was the size of my finger, middle of her chest. She was in tears almost every day. So, thinking of killing herself. And what are we going to do for this? So when we look at keloid, I call it keloid disorder, and we have talked about this quite a bit over the past few days. We're not dealing with scar. We may have to walk away from the term scar altogether. We're dealing with a group of conditions that we are putting in one basket, from patients who have one tiny spot of keloid lesions on their chest to someone like Alex who has a ton of keloids all over the place. So, and in managing these patients, we need to have a principle and have a plan as to how you're going to manage this patient. It's just not as simple as, okay, I'm going to cut this off, I'm going to do this. We really need to have a decent plan to take care of these patients. We're dealing with the genetic condition of skin. And regardless of how many patients report a family member having keloid, I truly believe this is 100% genetic condition of the skin. And we have a lot of asymptomatic carriers who are around and they don't report having any keloids. Not everybody would develop this after surgery. You do a lot of head and neck surgery, people recover very nicely, then you run into a patient like him who develops this keloid here. So, in my mind, this is a lifetime disorder, this is a genetic disorder, it's not going to go away anytime, you're going to have a lifetime battle with this, and then we need to really think through as to how are you going to manage these patients over the next many, many years. It's not a one encounter and goodbye. This is many years of encounter. So this is a chronic illness. This is like hypertension. We're not done with treatment of hypertension, diabetes, hemophilia. This is same category of illness. So we need to have a long-term plan of care. And when we have long-term plan of care, there are a number of things we need to keep in mind as we plan to treat these patients. As we treat them, we are exposing them to a risk. We have heard a lot about the risk in the past few days, including hyperglycemia from steroid injections. So one of the common interventions is surgery. So with surgery comes tissue loss. If you remove part of the earlobe in the process of treating keloid, you have some tissue loss and loss of earlobe. That is a risk. Recurrence is a risk. Worsening of the keloid, similar to what we saw, is a risk. Disfigurement of the ear is a risk. Radiation comes with a long-term carcinogenic risk. Those of you who don't know me, I'm a medical oncologist. I've treated a lot of patients with radiation therapy, so I know a lot about the risk of radiation therapy. So this also does come with some degree of risk. So how can we objectively assess the risk? So we know the risk, then we apply that to how we treat the patients. So once we know the risk, we can better educate our patients. So what tools do we have? We have retrospective data analysis. Treatment of keloid disorder, managing the patients, has to be data-driven. We are decades after decades of empirically treating keloid patients without having guidelines and guidances that would guide us as to how to treat the patient. So we need to analyze our data, and also we need to prospectively look at data that we generate from every single patient that we see. So then we end up with an evidence-based method of treating keloid patients that is data-driven. So over the past 7-8 years that I have been seeing keloid patients, I've seen close to 1,000 patients with keloids. So I've started in the past year to catalog all my patients and see what I can learn from them. So among close to 1,000 patients I've seen 283 patients with ear keloids. I'm going to go through this. 82 Asian, and this is the breakdown of that, 200 African Americans. And I photograph every patient almost every session. So when I look at these patients, I say, well, I have about 71 of these patients who have these tiny keloids. And this is how the ear keloids start. You get your ear pierced, you start with something that small, that if you leave it alone and don't get any treatment for it, imagine we have a successful method of treating these. If you don't intervene and we cannot get these to regress, they're going to grow, they're going to become bigger. But they are staying small, and I define small as a keloid that is smaller than the size of your earlobe. That's a very subjective definition. I couldn't find a better way of defining this because nothing exists in the literature to tell us how to categorize and group our patients. And I have a lot more patients who have these kind of keloids. You probably have the same kind of mix. And I would suggest for us to put our data together so we make a larger data set of these keloid patients. I have 181 patients, basically have keloids that I call them large because they are just bigger than the size of the earlobe. Again, my definition of the size. And they come in a lot of different ways. And among these 280 some patients, there are 18 patients who have keloids that I call semi-massive because the size of the keloid itself is larger than 50% of the size of your ear. So imagine how big your ear is. If the keloid is bigger than 50% of the size of your ear, I call it semi-massive. I have 18 of these patients. Two of them are Caucasian Asians, rest of them are African Americans. And the rest of my patients, there are 13 patients who have what I call massive ear keloids. These are keloids that are bigger than the size of your ear. And again, my definition of defining these, to group these patients. So I have 13 of these patients. So when you look at these patients, and I look at these patients, I have a bunch of questions come to my mind. How did these patients get there, especially the ones with semi-massive and massive keloids? Why are they living with these keloids? Why don't they get it treated? Why don't they get it removed? And how do these keloids impact people's lives? These are a ton of very good questions, and we should try to answer some of these questions. And is there a missing link? Is there something that I'm missing, that I'm not getting as to how these things have happened? So this is percentage of these patients. 4.6% have massive ear in my data set, and I hope that others can blend in their data with this to see what is the true incidence, prevalence of this. So we have almost 11% of patients who I have seen over the past 7-8 years with these very massive keloids, large keloids. This is an example of them. And then I asked this patient that, how did you get there? Just tell me, do you have any pictures to show that would show how did this whole thing start? And she said, well, several years ago I had a self-photograph. I mean, look at her ear. She had a piercing, there was no keloid there. And then she says, I pierced my ear a little later, I had this little bump there, and this is another picture. It's very blurry because I blew it up to see the ear. There's some swelling there. So this keloid became a little bigger as she had her first surgery. And then you see the scar of surgery here. There's some scarring here. After the surgery, she actually had another recurrence there. So anyhow, when I look at this 280 patients, I try to find a link between the semi-massive and massive keloid patients. These 13 patients, 100% of them had some form of keloid removal surgery in the past, anywhere between 1 to 7. The 18 patients with semi-massive, they 100% of them had surgery in the past. And the large ones, 73% of them had surgery in the past. So it puts this procedure in my mind as a risk factor for developing these large keloids. And I hope that we can all share our data to see if this is correct or not. They said, what about radiation? Can radiation fix these problems? So I'm going to show you data on radiation on these keloids, on this. And this doesn't show all 13 patients, but this is just one patient here. The rest of them are individual patients. And these are the patients who have had radiation therapy after the last surgery. And this is just one patient. As you can see, there has been just massive growth of keloids. So this combination did not help these patients. And so let's look at the neck area keloids. These are small anatomical areas, easier to look at. I have 82 patients in the past several years. And neck keloids start tiny, then become bigger. And I said, let me try to catalog these again, like I did for the ear. I ended up with 16 patients out of 82 that have these keloids that I call them massive. My definition is a keloid goes to both sides of the neck. And most of these, as you can notice, they are in submental, submandibular, and upper part of the neck, basically. These two patients reported that they have not had surgery in the past. These green dots mean these patients have not had surgery. This patient, I believe this patient just fumbled around the question that I personally asked him. This is one Asian, Caucasian patient who had these massive keloids. So it does happen in Caucasians less often. These are patients with semi-massive. In my definition, it's keloid that covers half of the neck, not the whole neck. This patient was the only one who reported she has never had surgery. Everybody else has had surgery. These are patients with large, and these are patients with basically smaller keloid. None of these have had any form of surgery in the past. And what is interesting is among Asians and Caucasians, the morphology is slightly different. These are the biggest and the worst in Asians. This is one of my worst patients with the neck area. In the earlier stage, of course, I showed you the worst one. So the next question was, you know, we're trying to attempt to categorize these patients. How can we categorize them? Why don't we have an established system of categorizing these keloids? In cancers, we have a staging system. We have TNM staging system. When we talk about breast cancer, we don't lump all the breast cancer patients in one trial and give them one drug and say, this is the result of treatment in breast cancer. We don't do that anymore. So we need a staging system for keloids. So I came up, this is my method of staging it based on whether or not the patients have the single keloid, the multiple keloid, and what is the size of their keloids, and how these keloid lesions sum up together. And then it gives you a staging system, stage 1 to 4, mimicking oncology staging system. So then you can apply this and say XYZ patient has stage 4C keloid that has his keloids, if you put them together, they measure more than 50 centimeters. So this may become helpful at some point, and again, certainly we need to verify validity and validate this staging system. But having said that, among these neck keloid patients, the ones with massive and semi-massive, they're a larger proportion. So we see more of this in neck patients, and among 31 patients, if you added up the massive and semi-massive, you have 31 patients. And out of these patients, 28 of them have had prior surgery before getting there. So again, I think this is a risk factor for these massive and semi-massive keloids. Same thing, in my opinion, applies to the rest of the keloids. This is a patient who had multiple surgeries on his scalp, back of the scalp, and you don't see pubic area. So when I think about this, I say, well, when we have primary keloids, keloids that have never been operated on, and we remove them surgically, certainly we have success in some patients. I've seen a lot of ear keloid patients that tell you and admit that there is success there. And when I talk about surgery, this is surgery plus any form of adjuvant treatment that we use. An adjuvant treatment that the patients accept. But we end up with patients who have secondary keloids. So we don't have a success, the keloid reoccurs. And if these patients go through surgery again and relapse again, and we operate them on them again, we're just getting into this cycle. And this is a cycle that spits out semi-massive and massive keloids. Again, this is my interpretation of my data. You can interpret this data in whatever way you wish. So how can we intervene? Is there a method that we can intervene? Do we have an alternative that would take place of scalpel? So I use cryotherapy as that alternative. And I'm going to show you some of these patients. So this is the first patient I showed you. This patient had let this keloid to become this big, very educated young woman. She had refused having surgery. She said, I'm not going to have surgery, I'll let this keloid grow. Then she came for an alternative treatment. So this was my alternative, I just applied cryotherapy to this, and this is the outcome. And this is the outcome, we achieved this outcome in about 8 months, but this patient comes to me for other keloids. This is 3 years later, this ear looks perfectly good right now. There is a little bit loss of pigmentation and there's skin atrophy there. And this is the side view of her ear. She wasn't exposed to a risk of surgery or radiation therapy. This is a 51-year-old woman who had bilateral earlobe keloids for 4 years, refused having surgery based on the information she had from very, very resourceful. She had accepted interlesional Kenalog before. This is her right ear. This is the right ear looking from back. The keloid has grown both sides. This is the other ear. She has keloid growing from both sides. So I would say if she were to have a resection of this keloid, I mean, the plastic surgeons here, they tell you how, they can tell us how this is removed. So, you know, let's try something else. Can we fix it with medical treatment? And this is what you can achieve with cryotherapy alone. You can debulk this keloid. Some of that keloid is within the body of this earlobe, which needs medical management. And for that, she receives intralesional Kenalog and gentle application of magnetic discs. And this is the opposite ear. So this is something that you can easily achieve with decent static outcome. How about this patient? She, after having two surgeries here and everything else, she was again offered surgery. She refused. And she said, I'm not going to have another surgery. I've had enough of loss of tissue here. So we said, let's freeze it. And with freezing the tissue, a few weeks later, there is necrotic tissue there. She heals. Some of the keloid came off, not the whole thing. Treated it again, became necrotic again. The mass went down, treated it again. And we ended up with this, just with total medical treatment. Have we cured this keloid? Perhaps not. Some of it is perhaps there. But again, this is an outcome you can achieve without taking this patient to operating room. This was achieved, and see how long it took. This is not something you can achieve overnight. Now, this patient started coming to see me actually this year with this large keloid. So I said, let's freeze and start using cryotherapy on this. So I immersed that part of it in liquid nitrogen. She came back the second time. This is second treatment, and part of that keloid had already kind of sloughed off. Froze it again. She recovered from it. The keloid became smaller. Froze it again and became smaller. And this is where she is now. We're not done with treating this. But this is a lot better than what it was before. This is another young African-American patient, 33-year-old, had four surgeries before. He had refused more surgery and has refused radiation. This is another thing we need to keep in mind, the refusal of the patients. I mean, the consent process is that we tell the patients what we think should be done. I suggest surgery, I say there's radiation, and the patient tells you, I refuse that. The patients have that right to refuse. So, all right, let's take it to medical treatment. But the same process, just freezing this, you can debulk this. And this patient was unable to sleep with this ear keloid. This is his opposite ear, the left side. And if you notice, this keloid had grown into his ear canal, and he had lost hearing in this ear. And this is what I was able to achieve with cryotherapy. And this patient said, I'm happy with this. I don't want to have any more treatment. We stopped basically there. He had some recurrence here, which I treated with intralesional chemotherapy. Several more examples of using straightforward cryotherapy in treating different sized keloids. And these are patients who have had multiple surgeries. These are examples of these primary, very small keloids, and you can easily remove them. So if you can remove those large keloids, and if you can remove these nicely, what would happen if you removed all of these primary ear keloids with cryotherapy? What kind of risk are we exposing the patients to? You're not exposing them to risk of tissue loss or radiation. And perhaps this is, again, 3 years later, we have a durable response there. And there are many more examples of ability to remove this. So if we are going to expose these patients to a risk, is this risk, in my data set, this may not be correct. Your data, if you add everything together, this risk may not be true. But are we going to expose these patients to 10%, 11% risk of developing semi-massive and massive keloids with our existing treatments? That's a real question. And who is to say, is 10% is an acceptable risk, or 1% is an acceptable risk, or 5% is an acceptable risk? But we need to sort this out. That's why we need data. That's why we need to be evidence-based in whatever that we do. Not only ear, you can treat the posterior auricular keloids. These are post-autoplasty keloids. that, you know, something this large came off totally with about five treatments. These are patients who have had facelifts, and you can nicely remove their keloids. It's a belly button keloid that came off completely with one cryo. She had a tiny recurrence treated with intralesional keloid. Pay attention to this. This is a patient who had some sort of, she had basically a midline laparotomy surgery, didn't develop any keloids there. I don't want to get into discussions of the natural biology of disease, but this is so interesting. Just two inches away, she had developed that keloid. Pubic keloids, and we talked about a very bad case that Dr. Burton had. This patient had only one course of cryotherapy. Perhaps this is not the ultimate or ideal result, but it is better than that, a fairly simple treatment. Neck keloid, another neck keloid. Without any invasive procedures, invasions, you can remove that, and this was a fairly recent 3-year follow-up. I don't have 25-year follow-up. I haven't practiced that long in keloid. This is one of my recent patients who have actually had prior surgery, and we were able to remove that. But face, this is a patient who, 31-year-old, has had surgery on his face, has had multiple recurrences, and didn't respond to ILK. And this is what you can achieve with cryo. We're talking about surgery for occipital acne keloidalis. This is a young gentleman who had had multiple injections and has had surgery to remove this. He came to me, this was infected, pus was coming out of this, and I treated that with cryotherapy. This is a result that we have 3 years later. Didn't make it worse. Now, besides the keloid recurrence, what is wrong in this picture? In this picture, this patient has had, this is one of my patients, has successful surgery but lost his earlobe. How common do we see that? And we need to report this in our outcomes of surgery to see what is the prevalence of that. And there's a handful of these patients who end up with disfigurement of their ears. Aesthetically, this is not an acceptable outcome. So the advantage of using cryotherapy, certainly this cannot be used for all keloids. This works perhaps for bulky keloids that are not too huge or to the size that I showed you. This cannot be applied to all the patients. But again, the ones that we can use it for is very easy to administer. It is safe, short-term and long-term. We are not giving any drugs to the patients. We don't even need local anesthetic for most patients. Very inexpensive, fairly available, and doesn't cause loss of tissue. How about this patient? I mean, I have about 7 of these patients who have these extremely painful chest keloids, and this patient has refused surgery. Intralesional chemotherapy, I stopped using 5-FU because of lack of significant efficacy. I treated this patient and several other patients with intralesional vincristine. The reason I chose vincristine is if vincristine extravasates, it's a drug used in treatment of cancer patients, it causes extravasation and loss of tissue and a host of problems. So I said if we inject it into a keloid, maybe it would do the same thing. And this patient got 5 micrograms of vincristine in that, and a few weeks later, this keloid crumbled on itself. So proof of principle that you can use a chemotherapy drug and induce that. After 3 injections, he has a significant reduction in the mass of his keloid. Again, vincristine doesn't work for everyone. In some patients, it does work, and we can use that. So this is what I did with this patient. Injected her with vincristine in one cycle, and this patient never came back to see me again. I said, oh my God, something went really bad. So I called her in October. I said, what happened to you? Never came back. I said, well, I have no pain. The pain went away in 2 weeks. And I'm very happy. I'm working, doing everything. Keloid is still there. As you notice, 7 months later, it has areas that kind of atrophied, and she had no pain at this point. So you can control the pain if you control the mass of that keloid. This is another example of a young Asian gentleman with this keloid in his chest that was treated with intralesional chemotherapy, and several weeks later you can basically achieve that. Anterior chest treated just with vincristine, and we can see decent results. But for a lot of patients who have bad keloids and lots of keloids, we need systemic treatment. This is what Rosalind referred to as treatment from inside. This is her terminology, layman terminology. But when you get to patients like these, There's no way I can use cryotherapy or intralesional chemo or anything of these, and there are lots of these patients. I show this picture to point to another interesting finding back in that neck area keloid. Look at these patients with this very bad chest keloids. They hardly have anything in their neck. So there's something about the skin of the neck that the process doesn't spread to. This is the one patient that I thought has a guttate spread of the keloid. So these patients, they need systemic treatment. There's no way we can treat these with local treatments. So in summary, I think a lot of patients may develop large, massive keloids after surgery, and we don't have any oral or intravenous drugs, and very few of us are researching this, and we really need to change this so that we would prevent something from happening. This is a very young person. Let me show her picture. I've had multiple surgeries here. Really, as physicians, need to avoid we need to consider treating early stage keloids with medical interventions and avoid performing unnecessary surgeries like plastic or cosmetic surgeries on patients who have keloid or are known to have keloid or have a family history of keloid. I'm going to stop here and answer any questions you may have.